In this video, we're going to talk about periodic functions. You see, we've already done functions that are defined on an interval and are tacked down at the two ends with Dirichlet boundary conditions. We developed Fourier series for those. Now we're going to do the same thing for periodic functions. Now there are three ways to think about a periodic function. One is to say, hey, it's a function on a circle. And what's a function on a circle? Well, you have to assign a value to this point, and you have to assign a value to this point, and you have to assign a value to this point and to this point. And if you want to take the inner product of two functions, you have to integrate over the circle. And what do you integrate? The conjugate of the first times the second. And I can call it d theta or ds. I'm integrating with respect to length along the circle. And we usually parameterize points on the circle by angle, in which case it would be f of theta conjugate times g of theta d theta integrated from 0 to 2 pi. Now the thing about the circle is you parameterize things by theta, what's this point? Is that theta equals 0, or theta equals 2 pi, or theta equals 4 pi, or theta equals 6 pi? It's all of these things. So if you wind up writing your function as a function of theta, or if you call it x instead of theta, you wind up saying that, well, f of 0 is the same thing as f of 2 pi, because they refer to the same point. And that's the same thing as 4 pi, because they refer to the same point. And in general, f of x plus 2 pi is always going to be the same thing as f of x because they're really the same point on the circle. And now you get a function that's defined as a function of a real variable, so it's a function on the line, but it repeats over and over and over again. So it's a periodic function on the real line is the same thing as a function on the circle. The last picture for periodic functions, and to do the inner product, we integrate over one period. So we integrate from 0 to 2 pi, or we could integrate from pi to 3 pi, or from pi over 2 to 5 pi over 2. You have to go all the way around once. Okay, so now that we've got those two pictures, we can do a third picture, which is that we're not going to think about functions on the entire real line, but we're going to think of functions on an interval from 0 to 2 pi. We're going to apply periodic boundary conditions, which is to say that the value at 2 pi is the same thing as the value at 0, the derivative at 2 pi is the same thing as the derivative of 0, and our inner product is the same as it was throughout. So, function on the circle, function on the line that keeps repeating, function on the interval that's doing the same thing at both ends, they're all the same thing. Now that's for period 2 pi. If you want period L, you can do the same, play the game. You can think about a function on a circle whose circumference is L instead of 2 pi. Or you can think of functions on the real line which have the property that they repeat every L. Or you can just think of functions on the interval from 0 to L with the conditions that the value at the endpoint, value at the beginning point, and that the derivative at the endpoint is the same thing as the derivative at the beginning point. Sorry about that getting out of focus for a moment. And we take the inner product by integrating from 0 to L of the conjugate of the first function times the second. And we call this space L2 of S1L. The S1 means a circle. L means a circle of circumference L. Okay, so now that we have a vector space, we can start looking at operators on that vector space. And the first thing to notice is that the adjoint of a derivative is minus a derivative. To see that, we write down the inner product of f with the derivative of g. And by definition, that's the integral of f bar times g prime. And we integrate that by parts. When you integrate by parts, you get f bar times g at the endpoints minus the integral of f bar prime times g. And f bar prime is the same thing as f prime bar. But f of x times g of x is the same at L as it is at 0, because f of L is f of 0, and g of L is g of 0. So this term isn't 0 at either end, but it's the same thing at both ends. So this adds up to 0. So we wind up with just the second term, which is minus the inner product of f prime with g. In other words, applying the derivative to g is the same thing as applying minus the derivative to f. The adjoint of the derivative is minus the derivative. Now, corollary of that is that if you look instead of the derivative, if you look at minus I times the derivative, its adjoint, you have to take the conjugate of I times the conjugate of the derivative of minus I times the conjugate of the derivative. The conjugate of minus I is plus I. Conjugate of the derivative is minus the derivative. So you wind up with minus I d by dx. So minus I d by dx is equal to its own conjugate. It's Hermitian. Second derivative, the conjugate of the second derivative, is you have to take the conjugate of the derivative times the conjugate of the derivative, and that just gives you the second derivative again. Two minus signs cancel. So the second derivative is Hermitian. So these are both operators that we will see quite a bit of. We usually call minus I d by dx, we call that p. And I'm going to just use the letter a for the second derivative operator. Both of them are Hermitian. And just as we did with functions with Dirichlet boundary conditions, what we're going to do is we're going to diagonalize these two operators. And those are going to give us a nice basis of functions in which to decompose functions. And we're going to get a version of Fourier series, two versions of Fourier series for periodic functions.